Jesus says that our whole life is going to amount to something, and that at the end of our lives, he is going to place into our hands everything that we were on this planet. And into our hands, he'll either place ashes or treasures. And what we choose during the days and weeks and months that we live determined whether or not we're going to end up holding ashes, which is everything we did that Christ puts through the fire and it didn't amount to anything, or treasures, which he clearly describes in his word as what we're to live for. Ashes or treasures? 1 Corinthians chapter 3, if you want to turn there with me, explains this to us, and that's where we're going to begin. And as you're turning there, I carry with me, everywhere I go, a little reminder of this truth of ashes or treasures. I carry with me a little piece of gold that every time I look at it, it reminds me of what Jesus said. Now, of course, it's what most of you have in this room that are married. It's my wedding ring. But every time I look at and wear and carry and think about that gold, I think about what it took to get that gold out of the ground and to get it made into a form that is precious. And I want you to think about that as we look, starting in verse 13 of 1 Corinthians 3, because most of you here this morning, to have anything made of gold or silver or precious gemstones, have a reminder, or after this morning's looking at this verse, will have a reminder. For everything of every day, of every hour, and of every moment we live, God is going to reduce to either smoke and soot, or to, as our verse is going to tell us, gold, silver, and precious stones. God is quite simple in how he refers to our lives. He says, I look at your life either as being something that's going to go up in smoke and just be soot and ashes, wood, hay, and stubble, or something that's going to be enduring and eternal and precious, gold, silver, and precious stones. Our life today reflects what we believe about the end result, what we desire. The little choices you and I are making today reflect whether we are thinking about ashes or treasures at the end of the line. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, starting in verse 13. Each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss. But he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Now, back up to verse 12 to see what the fire is going to burn. Verse 12 says, this fire that we just looked at is going to be burning what we built every day, every moment, every hour, every month, every week. Every amount of our earthly existence is being put together into a building. And that building is made of six types of materials. Either it's made, it says in verse 12, of gold, silver, and precious stones, or, verse 12 ends with, wood, hay, or straw. That is a very clear distinction. And that's how God looks at our life. It's not gray. It's either good or good for nothing. It's either enduring or it's going to burn up. It's either treasure or it's going to soon, after we invest so much of our life in it, turn out to be a handful of ashes. The first three substances in that 12th verse, gold, silver, and precious stones, are very identifiable. I mean, there's no doubt what gold is, nor has there been throughout the centuries. No doubt what silver is, nor has there been throughout the centuries. And no doubt about what precious stones are. But did you know it's not just because of the popularity of those items, it's because of the way God made them. I was fascinated. Let me just share with you. I revert to my favorite art of studying things, the background. Those materials are unique because gold, silver, and precious stones, because they're very hard to change them from what they are. What I mean by that is a precious stone, a gemstone, can be crushed, it can be ground. In fact, if you took a gemstone that you possess and took it to a flour mill where the huge rolling, crushing rollers came through and you reduced your precious stone to flour, every minute speck of it would retain the crystalline structure that made it precious to begin with. What do I mean by that? Well, take, for example, an amethyst. That's not the top of the line, but that is considered a precious stone. The amethyst is rhomboid. That tells the way the crystals form themselves. In structure, you can take your amethyst and whack it with a hammer, and every piece will retain and break in that rhomboid structure. You can grind it to powder and take a microscope, and every single speck of that amethyst will retain that rhomboid crystal structure. You go to topaz. Topaz is a little different. It's orthorhombic. That's a different shape the crystals take. Again, you take a topaz, precious stone, and you whack it, you crush it, you mill it, you make it to powder, and every single piece is identifiable by that orthorhombic crystalline structure. And you can go right down the line. Rubies are hexagonal. You can go through every single gemstone there is, and they will never lose their identifiable crystalline structure. Now you take gold. Gold is one of the most amazing metals in the world. It's the most malleable metal known. You can take gold, you can take 1 ounce of gold, and you could beat it and beat it and beat it, and it will continue to take the blows and never, never stop taking those blows, and it will begin to flatten out, and 1 ounce of gold could be made into a 50-mile long strand of pure gold. It never will break up. It just continues to take the beating and to thin down, and it's the most malleable substance known. It's also the least able to be ruined substance. There is no known thing that can ruin it except, of course, one, aqua regalia, the special properties of gold, that it is non-corrosive, it is non-able to be polluted by outside elements. And what he's saying is these are identifiable substances. They're scarce. They're hard to find. In fact, the first three, gold, silver, and precious stones, are below ground. Think about it. They're very clear. They're hard to find. You don't see them. Maybe a stream washes out and there's a gold nugget there down deep because it's so heavy, but they're very hard to find. But what about wood, hay, and stubble? I mean, the wood of trees, very common. The hay of the fields, the grass of the fields, it's everywhere on this planet. You can find one of those. One is very scarce. One is very common. Also, gold and silver and precious stones are very enduring. They can withstand all the elements. They can withstand fire. They can withstand water, storms, time. Gold is the most resistant metal. It won't tarnish. It won't discolor. It won't crumble. It won't be affected by most solvents. It's very precious. But look at the other three at the end of this verse. The other three substances that Paul names are all above ground. They're very visible. Wood of trees, hay of the grass, stubble of the straw. They're very fragile. You can either burn them or they'll die from insect attack or they'll rot when they get wet. They're very soft. They can be ground up. And you grind them up and they lose their identity. You grind up two trees and you can't tell hardly them apart because they don't retain a distinct identity. And after a while, they lose their identity when they decompose. They're very plenteous. They grow everywhere. Gold and silver and precious stones, though, have one problem. And that's what I think about when I look at my ring. The gold of this ring did not naturally occur like this. It wasn't beautiful and pure. Because the thing about these is that they are, in their natural state, not beautiful. They have impurities in them. They all need purging, refining, and polishing. Your precious gold jewelry is soft and beautiful, but it did not occur shiny like that in its natural state. Rather, the mineral gold is always mixed with a small amount of either silver or traces of copper, iron, or even lead. And that's why it has to go through a process to become precious. Think of this verse the next time you look at anything that shines with the luster of gold and silver or the beauty and iridescence of a precious stone. And then think of how it got there. Gold is an example that God has a plan to make us valuable, precious, and enduring. Because gold is always found in combination with other minerals, the process of refining or purifying gold to the point of where it's truly precious is a useful one. But if gold could talk, it's a costly process to the gold. What do they do to refine gold? Well, basically, they have to heat it with intense heat using caustic chemicals. And after that process, it goes from being impure to pure. Heat and caustic eating elements that process it. Well, when you look at some precious metal that's polished, like fine silver or gold, and look at its gleaming surface, you think about it, or even looking at a mirror with a fine coat of silver on the back of it, you think that that is precious and beautiful and costly. But it was very, very hard to get it to that point. That's what the Lord's trying to tell us through His Word, because God's pruning, we're going to see in John chapter 15, is His refining process through which He takes us as a believer and passing us through the intense heat and through the caustic cutting away of what is not shiny and lustrous and beautiful and precious in His sight. That process costs us dearly, but it produces for us something that's enduring. And something that is a treasure to God. As we undergo God's pruning, He is removing from us that which dims the image of Christ in us. And God has made a model or pattern that He follows as He fashions us. And that pattern is that God wants to see Christ reflected back in my life and in yours. And until He sees Christ reflected back, He continues the intense heat, He continues the caustic things that have to come into our life, He continues the hands-on pruning of our lives until He sees Christ formed within us. Now that means it's a lifelong process. Now that process, if you want to back up to the Gospel by John, is where we find ourselves. And I would like to explain to you how to abide satisfied. That means how to go through life abiding, knowing, and satisfied that what God is doing, He is doing well. And I am cooperating. And I want Him to do that. And I want Him to see the image of Christ in me. And I want to abide in Him. And I want to awaken. As the psalmist says, I will be glad when I awaken in your likeness. And that's all of our goals. Let's read that described. That's in John chapter 15. And I'm going to read with you those first 8 verses. John 15, Jesus speaking, saying this. Verse 1, I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, He prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and withers. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So you will be my disciples. Let's bow before Him. Father, I pray that we will realize that in our natural state, we are not the way you want us to be. And you want to refine us. You want to purge us. You want to polish our lives and make us precious for eternity. You want to remove what is going to be ashes in our lives, and you want to replace it with treasure. You want us to build with gold. You want us to build with silver. You want us to build with precious stones. And Father, we know we're not perfect. We know we don't always respond. But you are patient and you are loving. And you want us to abide in you. And so you've commanded. And you want us to cooperate and be satisfied that you are the one who knows best. So teach us from your word by the power of your Spirit as we open our hearts and from our wills respond. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. I want to walk through each of the little phrases starting in verse 1. And I want to show you the depth because each of these phrases is so deep. The first part is, it says in verse 1, I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. Now we know much about God being revealed to us in Jesus Christ and us being connected to him as the vine. What we don't usually think about is the second part of verse 1. To us, we know very little of the last word of this sentence, vine dresser. Another way would be the gardener. Another way would be the farmer. Whatever you want to call it, that's what God the Father designates himself as. Now that should be uplifting. Next time you're out working in your yard or your garden or if you're an agricultural business, you ought to be pretty pumped by that because God considers himself a farmer, a gardener, a vine dresser. But what does that mean? I mean, to us, that is so foreign. Well, let me just describe a little bit about what vine dressing is about. Our Father, the vine dresser, is introduced here in verse 1. He is looking at us. Remember, Jesus says, I'm the vine, you're the branches, my Father is the gardener that's looking at this vine and branch configuration. So the first thing it introduces is the interrelationship of our triune God. And what he says is, I am the one that you are connected to livingly. When you come to faith in me, you are joined to me. And so we are branches connected to Christ, our vine. And that relationship and that union and that ongoing process of our growth is overseen by God the Father. What's he doing? Well, think of what vine dressers did back then. He's looking at the connection that we have to the vine. He's looking at the production of what's in our life. Specifically, God the Father is our personal gardener, and he's looking for one thing that's repeated. Did you notice I kept emphasizing it as I read? Fruit, 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 fruit. 6 times in the verses I read, 2 more in the verses that follow, 8 times altogether in this passage. Do you get an idea of what God's looking for? What do you think he's looking for? That's right. And he's looking for fruit in our lives. And fruit is what's produced by God in my life that will last forever. That will not turn to ashes. That will be treasure in his sight. So he's looking for treasure produced and built in my life and to take away what will become ashes and will become meaningless in eternity, in heaven, in his presence. Fruit is what's produced by God through Christ in my life that will last forever. Now, how does he do this as a vine dresser? Well, think about this. God is walking down the rows of vine branches here. He's walking through looking at us. You can imagine that all of us are vines, and he's walking up and down these vines looking at us. What is he looking for? He's looking at those who are listless, those who have empty branches, and he's trying to bring them back to being a vibrant, growing part of this vineyard. He's taking his eyes and examining each branch to see where it's headed. Now, you know, if you know anything about vineyards, if the branch goes down and gets out of sunlight, it will stunt its growth. It needs to have those leaves to use the process of the solar furnace that empowers the whole photosynthetic process of bringing nutrients in, causing growth, and the ultimate, to produce fruit. So if that vine is growing in the wrong direction, he's going to get down there and pick that up as the gardener and weave it back in where it should be. Or if that vine is cast down and is in the mud, growing along the ground, far from the light of his presence, he's going to do something about it. He's going to look at each leaf, and if they're caked with the soil of the earth, he will clip away that part that perhaps has started to get yellow and dead. He'll clip away that part that is diseased. That's what gardeners do. And that's what God is doing in our lives. That's what he's doing in our lives through the events, through the details, through the unexpected and the expected, and through the disappointments and everything else. They become not disappointments to us, but God's appointments as he is examining our lives, trying to cleanse what is salvageable, weaving us back into fruitfulness, restoring and pruning us. But if you looked at the vineyard, you would be amazed, because there's this huge pile of stuff that God keeps coming back and carrying and throwing there. And you would feel the fire as all that trimmed away branches and dead wood is burning. And that's what went on in vineyards. 90% of the vine was trimmed back every year. 90%. And that was the initial pruning. Then all year long, the gardener would keep patrolling and making sure that that vine was headed toward production of fruit. So God is going to get rid of anything that impedes the fruitfulness of us in our lives. Now, think with me about what Jesus would have pointed out to his disciples. Remember where this whole passage, and if you haven't noticed this lately, Jesus is up in the upper room in chapter 13. He's washing his disciples' feet. He talks to them about this. And then at the end of chapter 14, he has gotten through his first part of his discourse, and they're walking by chapter 15 toward the Garden of Gethsemane. And so Jesus is walking his disciples, and they are actually seeing, as he talked, they're outdoors, they're seeing vines and branches. Because everywhere in Jerusalem, they were growing these things. Even in the courtyards they passed, if they had gone outside the wall, vineyards would have grown all along that Kidron Valley. And so Jesus is pointing to them. And think what's in their minds. Because in Christ's time, the vine dresser would prune the branches in two ways. And Jesus was reminding them of that. He would cut away dead wood that would breed disease. And he would cut away living branches that were either headed the wrong way or had no sign of any fruit being produced from them. So, back to verse 1, my Father is the vine dresser. Spiritually, in your mind, put this in there. God, the vine dresser, is going to prune me, Christ's branch, and anything dead or diseased in my life, he's going to get rid of. Anything that doesn't have the life of Christ in it, and also anything that is alive and good, but is not headed toward his results, he's going to be watching that, and if he doesn't get out of me what he wants to produce fruit, he's going to trim it. That's the concept Christ is giving. In our lives, God doesn't just want quality, he wants quantity. See, God wants something produced in our life. That's why that farmer would cut away the even little buds that were growing so that one cluster of grapes would grow larger, and that would be... See, in our culture in America, we want to cover more ground and get more done. God wants us to grow and mushroom and flourish in the fruit department. So he not just wants this beautiful quality branch, he wants quantity of fruit, and he cuts things off. The greatest judgment that God could bring to us as a believer is to just leave us alone. In fact, that's what Romans 1 is all about. Romans 1 is God saying, okay, I'm going to let them alone and let them do what they want. And what does mankind left to its own do? We just get worse and worse and worse. And you read the decline and fall of the human race in Romans chapter 1. And left to ourselves, unjudged by God and unimpeded by his grace, we just decline. So the worst thing God could do for you is leave you alone. The worst thing he could do for me is just say, okay, I'll let them live their life the way they want. Our Heavenly Father is near us. He's tending our lives. He's encouraging us to bear more fruit. And he's never closer to us than when he's doing that trimming, just as the gardener. Well, Jesus is cutting away through his Father's tender hands. And look in the text. Look at verse 2. Sometimes he's cutting away every branch of me that doesn't bear fruit. He takes away every branch that bears fruit. He prunes that it may bear more fruit. He purges. The word actually speaks of cleans. He is cleaning us. He's trimming us. He's purging us. In fact, look back at chapter 13 in verse 10. Because the very same word that is used in verse 15, or chapter 15, verse 2, is the same word in verse 10. Jesus said to him, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet and is completely clean. There's the word that the word purged or pruned or cleaned is in chapter 15. We are clean through Christ. And anytime we're not clean, anytime we get, to use his metaphor, anytime we get dirt on our leaves, anytime we get caked with mud because we're growing down where we shouldn't be, he comes and he's cleaning us. So sometimes, back to chapter 15, he simply uses his word to convict and cleanse us. Doesn't it happen to you? Doesn't it happen regularly when you open the word of God? This week, as I was listening to God's word in my car, many times, it just words that I read all the time jumped out at me because I heard them spoken. And that word convicts. It shows us where we're not where God wants us to be. And that word also cleanses us. See, the Word of God sanctifies and cleanses us. So sometimes, all that God has to do is expose us to His Word, and that cleans us. Sometimes, He has to chasten us. When we're cast down, to use the metaphor, in the mud of sin, God has to do something about it. Look over at Hebrews chapter 12. That's the classic chapter on chastening. Hebrews 12. The first 11 verses. And what this says, and when we get to this whole concept of chastening in a couple of weeks, we'll go through every word of this. But it says in Hebrews chapter 12, starting particularly in verse 7, if you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons. For what son is there who he does not chasten? Chasten is when God radically has to get in there and just that if that vine is growing down in the mud, he has to pull it out of the mud. And you know what? That is a very, very drastic event. Or if there's disease, I know that in my rose garden, sometimes they get this blight and one whole branch will start growing all deformed and you have to just radically go back to where it's not even thick and you cut off the whole thing and you remove that part. And God has to do that in our lives, and that's called chastening. And sometimes he has to chasten us if we're cast down in the mud of sin. He spiritually has to lift us back up into the sunlight of his fellowship, and sometimes it hurts. But he'll do anything for us to get a crop. Back in John 15 again, the next thing God does is that he wants to cleanse us, which he does through his word. Sometimes he has to radically chasten us, which he does by just intervening in our life. But most often, it's what it's talking about in verse 2, what the vine dresser does most of all. The vine dresser is constantly clipping. You know, I do this all the time with our flowers out in our deck. They love to go to seed. And I have to cut off all, in the herbs too. They're always trying to go to seed. And if you keep cutting them, they find new places to grow. And they find to redirect that energy rather than to seed, they redirect it into growth. And God is always clipping. I mean, every time I go out to see the kids on the way, I bring a pair of scissors and I just take that extra moment to stop them from going the wrong way to seed. And I want them to keep growing. God says, I'm pruning all the time. If we're flourishing, if we have external growth, but we're not producing much fruit, he prunes us. He cuts away our rambling growth. God prunes us so that our quantity keeps up with our quality. And so that we not just have this luxuriant growth in our lives, but that we focus on what matters to him and we have fruit. And finally, if we're fruitful and bearing more fruit, the end of this, look at verse 8. God isn't content with us just bearing fruit or bearing more fruit. Look at verse 8. He says, I want you to bear much fruit. So the neat thing about chapter 15 that we're going to find is this passage speaks to every believer. There are no believers that are out of God's radar range. There are no believers that are not being looked at by God. It doesn't matter if you're a little believer, a medium believer, a big believer. It doesn't matter if you're a young believer or an old believer. Every branch. Verse 2. Every branch. God is talking to every young person, every mom and dad, every career person, every senior person. God is talking to us. He says, every, verse 2, branch, everyone who has confessed him as Lord and Savior. He said, I want you to understand what I'm doing. Second thing about verse 2, not only is he talking to every branch, he's talking to believers. Look at the next part of verse 2. Every branch, what are the next two words? In me. Now that's, this is the key that unlocks the whole passage. If you understand those two words, all of a sudden you know what John 15 doesn't mean. If you understand those two words, you know what it doesn't say. Let me just give you a little study, because there's 25 reasons why I believe that all 8 verses of John 15, all 8 of them, including the fire, including the cast out, including the takeaway, all 8 verses talk to believers. And it's because of those two little words. Because every time in this book, which is 25 times, those two words are used, every single time, it only means one thing. Let me show you what I mean. Let's go back to John 6 in verse 35. And we'll do, now you can be in an intense word study. This is one of the fun parts of studying the Bible. You do word studies. You look at how God uses a word and what it means. The best way to interpret the Bible is not pull down your favorite commentary. It's not pull out a book. It's to, first of all, exhaust what the Bible has to say about whatever it is you want to know about. Because the best commentary on the Bible is the Bible. John 6 and verse 35. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never hunger. And he who believes..." What are the next two words? "In me shall never thirst." Okay? So is that a believer? You bet it is. Look at verse 47, same chapter. John 6 and verse 47. "Most assuredly I say unto you, he who believes in me..." Believes, that would be sufficient, right? But he says, I want you to make sure about this. "He who believes in me has everlasting life." So what we can say is, "in me" is another way of saying that they are believers and that they have everlasting life. The way we come to that is by being in Christ. Now look at verse 56. Same concept. Another verse. It says, "He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides," what? "In me." He's not talking about communion here. He's talking about salvation here. He's saying that those who are believers are eating of him. They have, see, the unique thing about eating is you only can eat for yourself. If I eat, it doesn't help you. Unless you partake, you don't get any benefit. And what he's saying is only those who have personally partaken of me. See, we don't have any surrogate or proxy salvations. You aren't saved because your mother is. You aren't saved because your dad is. You aren't saved because your wife is. You aren't saved because your children are. You aren't saved because your friends are. There's no proxy. You have to eat of Christ for yourself. You have to drink of him for yourself. So what he's saying is the way you get in me is to receive me. Look at chapter 7 and verse 38. And I'm not going to go through all 25 of these, but you can, and you'll find it's the same in every one. Verse 38, "He who believes in me." Every single time that little Greek preposition is used, every time it means that they are a believer. And he says, if you have believed in me, then you have this river of the water of life. Chapter 10, verse 38, same idea in 10:38. Though you do not believe me, believe the works that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. In me. I mean, there's no more sure thing. Jesus said, your salvation is based on unbreakable things, and that is that I and my Father are one, and we together offer you this salvation, and it is something that you cannot doubt, and that cannot be broken. It's by two immutable things. By my promise, by my sacrifice, he says, in me. Chapter 11, verse 25, same thing. I just love these. He says in 25, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, yet shall he live." And chapter 14, verse 1, that great assurance verse, which you all know. "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me." That's a believer that believes in him. Now let's get back to chapter 15. I could go through, there are tons of them in chapter 14, but in chapter 15, look at the numerous times he says that. Verse 2, "Every branch in me." Now if 24 times in this book alone, he says "in me," and every single time he says it, he's talking about a living, saving connection. Why would he change gears in the middle of this verse? Because look what it says in verse 2. "Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Verse 4, abide in me. At the end of verse 4, you can't do this unless you abide in me. Verse 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me. Verse 6, if anyone does not abide in me. Now see, right there is where people start getting nervous. But wait a minute. Verse 4, when he said this whole, introduced this idea of abiding in verse 4, that's an imperative. It's a command. God commands those who are in Christ to abide. It's not a given. It's not a natural. It's not an automatic. It's not something that will just happen. It's a choice we make. And so what happens, and we're going to see this when we get to it, in verse 6, those who choose to not stay close to Christ in fellowship, in communion, in worship, in his word, in obedience, those who don't do that, those who don't cooperate with him and build their lives seeking to please him, look what he has to do. He has to cast them out as a branch. He has to actually walk down the row and says, look at what they're doing. And he pulls out what I carry every time I go outside. I carry my red trimmers. And we have a lot of roses, and some of them are just going like this, and some of them they have these branches, and they go straight out, and they're trying to get the kids when they run by. And I come along with my clippers, and I just grab that thing, go, cut that right off. And you know what it does? As soon as it's perfectly, beautifully alive, I go, and I throw it down on the deck and go looking for some more. When I come back, what's happened to that branch? What it says right there in verse 6, it withers. You see, it was very much alive, and it was in me before. So immediately, we know this. We know from the preponderance, from the complete revelation of God, that God says that you cannot lose your salvation. He has said that so many times, it sounds like he's got a problem with repetition and overdoing it. He said that. So we know this doesn't mean that he cuts off a believer and says, you're going to burn in hell. So what this is talking about is pruning, which is painful and costly, but a part of life. And anybody here that has ever gone through God saying, I don't want you going that direction in your life, and you resisted him, you know the pain of him redirecting you. Well, every one of the times that John records in me, it refers to a believer or his place in relationship to the triune God. So it's hard to imagine, look at verse 2, that the Lord switches gear in John 15:2, and he says, this one who is unfruitful is unsaved. Why? Because all believers go through times of being unfruitful. All of us do. If we didn't, there would be nothing to burn at the judgment seat of Christ. He said that there is going to be amounts of our life that are wood, hay, and stubble. If all of us were fruitful all the time, where would that come from? You see, we have to think about him saying that some of you are going to suffer loss. Some of you are going to weep. Some of you are going to, at that time, be weeping because you realize that your life was not lived right. That's the unfruitful times in life. All believers go through seasons of fruitlessness. If you want to verify that, think back over your own spiritual pilgrimage. Unless you just got saved last week, every one of us could talk about the times we felt far from God, we felt cold, we felt distant, and we knew that in that one area of our life or time period, we were not obeying him. Well, in me, in Christ, means to be saved. And there are great words in the Bible like propitiation, reconciliation, redemption that cover phases of salvation, but the entire spectrum of salvation is covered by that one phrase, in Christ or in me. So we're dealing with believers. And what this verse does, when he says, every branch in me, what it does is it unlocks the truth that all of this passage, all the truths in here, all the concepts are for every believer, and all of them apply to all of us. So that's why, to me, it's so exciting, because this whole 8-verse section is so important. Christ's central theme of John 15, 1 through 8, is not salvation. It's not how to obtain salvation. It's not how to be in danger of losing salvation. Instead, the great theme is fruitfulness. Now, circle in your minds with me these occurrences. Look at verse 2. Every branch of me that does not bear what? fruit. Keep reading. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes. Keep reading in verse 2, that it may bear more fruit. Look at verse 4. Abide in me and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit. There's the fourth time it occurs. Verse 5, he who abides in me and I in him bears fruit. Verse 6, he who abides in me, they gather and, get down to verse 8. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. And if you kept reading through this passage, you'd find out that 8 times he mentions fruit. Now, do you remember what numbers mean? Do you remember there are 7 days in a week? Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. The 8th day starts over again with Sunday. Do you remember that there are 7 notes in the musical scale and the 8th note starts over again, that scale? Do you remember that even in the spectrum there are 7 colors? And when you get to the 8th color, you're just repeating and you're going back through. 7 is always a number of a complete set, but 8, always in the Bible, if you look up every event that occurred on the 8th day, every one of them speak of something with a new beginning. And what he's saying is this chapter is about, and this passage is about fruit. And the word 8 occurs, the word fruit occurs 8 times, and 8 is a resurrection number. It's associated with a new beginning. It's a number of new creation. And if these facts are kept in mind, that's what this is all about. He says, I want to give you a new beginning in making your life a treasure. A new beginning in saying, Lord, I have a choice today. I can either build up more ashes and more worthless stuff, or I can build up more treasure, more gold, more silver, more precious stones. And Lord, by your grace, I want to make the choice for what's eternal. That's what life is about. It's a new beginning in fruit bearing. But is it really possible for a believer who's attached to Jesus to be fruitless? Is it possible? Well, Jesus says so. Look what he says in verse 2. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, I'm going to do something about it. But look what he says. Look at this. Every branch in Christ, that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Who is he? Verse 1. Look at the relationship. See, this whole passage is tightly tied together. The whole passage is a beautiful metaphor. It's a beautiful picture from everyday life, a common picture with a profound spiritual message. And Jesus said in verse 1, I am the vine, my Father's the vine dresser, you're the branches. And if your branch is not doing what it's supposed to do, verse 2, he, the vine dresser, is going to do something. You catch that? God is on duty 24/7. God is always looking to see how us branches are doing. What is it that he does? The whole idea of what God does is he is involved with us bearing fruit. And not every branch is going to bear a bumper crop, just as not every field has a bumper harvest. The Lord has already said that. Do you remember where we started back in Mark when we were starting on this whole fruitfulness? He said some bear 30-fold, some 60, and some what? 100. There are some that are the much fruit stage. There are some that are in the more fruit, and there are some that are just in the fruit. But God says when there is a period of time in the growing season of life that you and I, for whatever reason, are not being fruitful for him. Verse 2, he, Iro is the Greek word, takes away. Now that's the next thing we're going to study. What does that word mean? It says in John 15:2, takes away. Now the best thing to do before you get out your theology book and start wondering about if he's taken away and they're going to hell, or if he takes them away because they're a fake Christian, you ought to look at every other time outside this verse that word occurs. That's what I would do. In fact, I did it for you, so I thought we'll look at it together, okay? Takes away, everywhere else in the Bible, means to lift up or to raise up. Every other time it's in the Bible. Never means take away, as we know it here, which would be kind of like getting rid of. It doesn't speak of getting rid of. It speaks of raising or lifting up. And if you want to think about this in the metaphor, what is he talking about? He's talking about branches. A branch that's not bearing fruit, most common thing it would do is it was out of the sunlight. It had gotten down there in the dark where it's in the shadows all the time, down there perhaps too close to the road, and so he has to lift it up. If you know what they do, they weave them in so that they will grow in the direction and along a profitable way. They would have trellises, actually. And even to this day, if you cross the country and see vineyards, you'll see how they attach the vines. And any that grow down, it's just like if you're training your roses, you connect them back on the trellis. That's what this is talking about. Let me show you what I mean. Because an accurate rendering of this word is in the book of Matthew, to give you an example. Look at Matthew 14 and verse 20. Don't lose your place in John. We'll be right back there. But look at Matthew 14 with me and verse 20. Because an accurate rendering, and what's interesting is the translators of the Bible have before them these verses. And they have to make choices. Look what chapter 14 and verse 20. They choose to say, now they all ate and were filled, and they took up, Iro, 12 baskets. What did they do? Did they take 12 baskets and dump them somewhere? What does that verse mean? It says they walked around and the people gave them and they lifted up and put into their baskets the leftover food. Another one, keep going to chapter 27. This one is a graphic. Matthew 27, same word. This is what Jesus says, or Matthew records about Christ. It says, and they came out and found a man of Cyrene, Matthew 27, verse 32, Simon by name, and they compelled him to... Now, what had Jesus just done with the cross? He had fallen down with the cross. He was cast down. And so they compelled Simon to throw Jesus Christ out, to get rid of it? No. To pick it up and bear it up and take it where it needed to go. And I could give you every other word picture, but in the Bible and in Greek literature, this word, go back to John 15, and let me conclude with this. In the scriptures, in all of Greek literature, this word iro never means to cut off. Nowhere, anywhere, in any scripture, or in any use in the Greek language, does that word iro ever have the usage of being cut off and gotten rid of and thrown away and destroyed. It always means something about being lifted up. And so when the Bible renders this as takes away or cut off in John 15, it gives an impression that they're lost and they're thrown out. And that's unfortunate because it's never used that way. So lifts up is a better image, and it speaks of the image of the vine. And what a comforting thought to see in this passage, our loving Heavenly Father coming down the rows of His Son's vineyard, finding a cast down branch and doing something. What does He do? He lifts some back up into the sunlight. Did you know people get fruitless at times when they're out of fellowship? You know, we were camping, but I took the kids to the campfire. I couldn't wait. I built a big campfire, and I said, watch, I'm going to show you something. And I took the stick, and I pushed all the boards that were burning, all the logs. I pushed them out, and then I separated all the coals in the fire, and I had the buddies stand there. I said, watch. And they were just, playing in the fire was exciting. Dad was playing it at this time, and they watched. And I said, watch. And one by one, every one of the burning logs stopped burning. And all the blue-white, glowing, intensely hot coals went to red and then lessened until a gray sheet of ash, and they slowly cooled down. Why? Because they burn brightest when they are together, and when that combined effort of the air coming in and them helping each other with their heat cause it to burst into a hot fire. The first thing God does with fruitless people is tries to get them back into fellowship. He takes the mud and dirt off of them. He pulls them up when they're trampled, and He wants them to bear fruit. You and I in our natural state are not lustrous and shiny. God says, I'm going to do something in your life. I'm going to refine you. I want to get out of your life whatever it takes so that you will be a treasure in my hand and not ashes. Now, it's something different in each of our lives. But that's what God the Father, the vine dresser, is doing. Let's bow before Him and tell Him we want to cooperate. Father in heaven, I thank You that You are the vine dresser and that You want us to bear fruit. You say that 8 times. And if we are cast down, You want to lift us up. If we are caked with dirt and mud because we've been down too close to the dirt, You want to clean us off. And if we're getting trampled in the pathway of life, you want to gently weave us back. But we have to cooperate. We have to say yes. We have to say, Lord, cleanse me. Prune me. I want to be bearing fruit. So help us not to just hear this, but help us to do this as we yield to you by your grace. In the name of Jesus, we ask that you will find us as gold and silver and precious stone buildings by choice this week. Amen.